So hello, my today's presentation will be about blockchain scaling, or more precisely one of blockchain scaling concepts called Lightning Network. A few words about me. I'm Tomasz Konieczny. I work at Excel as Senior Quality Assurance Engineer. And I'm interested in blockchain-related subjects since 2011. So, plan of this presentation. At the beginning, I will tell you why we even need some blockchain scaling concepts. In the second part, I will show you one of these concepts called Lightning Network, how it works in the very high level. And at the beginning, a bit of history to show you some aspects of blockchain that are related to some events. So it's 2008, it's during financial crisis, and a person called Satoshi Nakamoto published a white paper describing a peer-to-peer electronic cash system called Bitcoin. And just a few months later, the first release of Bitcoin was published, and that's the time where first the Genesis block was generated. So it was the beginning of Bitcoin's blockchain. This financial crisis, in some ways, defined the goals that Satoshi tried to achieve in his transaction system. The very important goal was that it should be secure, because no one would use a transaction system that just isn't secure, so it's quite a standard thing. But other goals are not that standard, because the system should be independent, so no one would be able to, for example, seize assets in this transaction system. It won't be related to any, for example, banks. We won't need third parties that we have to trust, like, for example, banks or financial institutions. And very important thing is that it should be censorship resistant. So it won't be possible to undo the transaction while it's already done. So the solution that made these things possible is, as you know, blockchain. But what are the possible problems with it? Because there are surely many advantages of using it. But what about problems? Because there definitely has to be some disadvantages of it. Just a day after Satoshi published his white paper on the mailing list, a person replied, "We very, very much need such a system, but the way I understand your proposal, it doesn't seem to scale to the required size." So just a day after publication of the white paper, someone replied that it won't be possible to scale it to the size that probably would be needed in some point. Because he also write there that if the network would grow to, for example, millions of users or hundreds of millions of users, the amount of transactions would be significant. And that would be a real problem to propagate these transactions across the network. And also the amount of data that has to be stored would be huge in this case. I will show you the example that probably would be better to visualize it. So here is a node making the transaction. And then this transaction must be propagated across the network, because we need a global consensus there. So every transaction must be synchronized in network. And also there has to be some solution for storing it. So it would be stored on every node, every full node in the network. And currently, there are like 9,000 Bitcoin nodes across the world. And so there are 9,000 nodes that have to store every transaction that was ever made. And the amount of data would be huge at some point. Also, biggest problem probably here is that these transactions must be synchronized. So when the block is generated, every node has to update its state. And Satoshi's answer was that long time before it would happen, so before that would be like tens of millions of users, the users will be able to just use the simplified payment verification to validate the transactions. They won't need full clients like normal users. That the infrastructure would be based on the specialized hardware, specialized companies, huge server farms that would run the network. And that's in most cases true, because we currently have some huge mining farms across the world. But in case of Bitcoin, the real scaling problem appeared even earlier, because we have something like a block size limit. Why there is even some limit of the block size? Because it's a very simple solution for the spamming attacks, because the first versions of Bitcoin clients weren't that fast like the current ones, and there were severe performance issues there, especially the validation time of transactions. And Satoshi just limited the block size to 1 megabyte to prevent these attacks. This wasn't a problem back then, because there just weren't any users of Bitcoin there then. But currently, when there are more users, this limit that allows us to do just 7 to 20 transactions per second is definitely too low. And the problem is even bigger, because this block size limit is a consensus rule. So we are not able to change it in any way that is easy. The possible ways of changing it, the first one, the on-chain scaling solution. So the idea is quite simple, as it looks probably, because it's just to increase this block size to, for example, 2 megabytes, 16 megabytes, or remove the limit, or decrease the block size. But the problem is that it would require the hard fork, what means that update of every full client on the network would be required to change this limit. Because if someone generates a block incompatible with this consensus rules, it would be rejected by the rest of the network. And also, even changing this block size limit and updating of these clients, it won't solve the performance problems, like propagating these huge blocks across the network. But the question is, do we really need every transaction stored on-chain? Do we really need to commit every transaction to the blockchain? Because I think that blockchain is often treated like a goal to achieve, like we want to use it because it's interested. It's the new technology. Everyone likes new technologies. But I think that blockchain should be just a solution of real problems. We need it definitely here as this security layer, but I think nothing more. So the goal in this case is to increase the network's capacity, to be able to make more transactions. And other ways of solving this. What about smart contracts? Because you maybe know, but it's possible to write smart contracts on Bitcoin's blockchain. It was possible even a few years before the Ethereum's white paper appeared. One of the ways of solving this is to use smart contracts and build a layer above the blockchain. It's a concept called off-chain scaling concept, and it's about building a blockchain above and building a layer above blockchain. So some of the data would be stored off-chain. It won't increase the block size that fast like currently. And also, it would be easier to make transactions in the time that we want, like, for example, seconds and not this 10 minutes, like we have to wait for the block to be, for the transactions to be configured in the block. But we definitely need blockchain here too, because it's our security layer. So blockchain is definitely needed here. It would be used like an arbiter. It's known as blockchain as arbiter. Like, for example, in real life, we make some transactions on contracts, and we don't have to go to court every time. So blockchain is our security layer here. And we can think about it like a protocol. For example, we build web applications over HTTP, and in this case, we would just build another second layer over the blockchain. And one of these scaling concepts or second layers is Lightning Network. It's a concept that was published by a few Bitcoin developers to solve the scaling problems about 2.5 years ago. And the description for it was scalable off-chain instant payments. Scalable like millions to billions of transactions per second. Off-chain as a method for solving it. And instant like milliseconds to seconds for transaction to be finished. And it's all based off Bitcoin's functionality called bidirectional payment channels. So this channel is a solution that allows us to make transactions without committing them to the blockchain. So we can make a transaction, then update its state as long as we want. And when we consider it as finished, we can commit it, and that would be all of it. I will show you the example, because it would be better to describe it by the example. On classic on-chain transactions, if we want to send funds, we'd have to make we have to commit every transaction on-chain. So, for example, there are Anne and John here, and they send funds to each other very frequently. And for example, there are 50 transactions here. So, for example, and send some value to John, like 2 millibitcoins, then she sends again like 3 millibits, and then John sends to her 4 millibitcoins. And for example, there are 50 more transactions here. And in classic on-chain approach, every transaction would be stored on the blockchain. So every transaction would increase the blockchain size, and we will have to propagate every transaction across the network, because we need the global consensus here. And why we want to save everything on-chain? Do we really need it? Because I think that the most important part here is that the final state would be saved on-chain, and the rest is just the temporary state that we don't need here. And with payment channel, that would be just two transactions. Anne and John would be able to open a payment channel between their nodes. Then they are able to make as many transactions as they want off-chain without committing them to the blockchain. And then in closing transactions, they can save the final state to the blockchain. So there will be just two transactions that won't increase blockchain size that much. Everything would be fast, because there isn't required to wait for the block, for the confirmation in the block. So the transactions would be instant, because it's just updating of the state between two nodes that have payment channel opened. So it definitely reduces the amount of data that has to be propagated across the nodes. But why is the network world in Lightning Network? Because it's the name of this concept. The small dots you can see here are Lightning nodes. These lines you can see are the payment channels connecting these nodes. It's like building a huge network of payment channels connecting nodes. So it's possible to route a transaction across the network through other nodes, like we are able to route information through the internet. The only difference is that here we are sending value, we are sending money instead of information. So it's about building a huge payment network with this quite simple payment channels. I will show you the example here, how it can work. N isn't directly connected, N's node isn't directly connected with Bob's node, but they are connected by other nodes. So it's possible to route the transaction through these nodes. And what is important here is that everything here is secure. It's based on smart contracts. More precisely, hashed time lock contracts that make it possible that all transactions will be executed, so it would be routed through all nodes, or the transactions will be rejected and returned to the sender. And in this case, there are three routes that can be selected by the nodes. So payment from N can be sent to John, then to the Scott, and for Bob. The second, probably simpler path, because there are just two hops is here, is sending to the N and then to Bob. And the third one would be sending to Colin, Hannah, and then to Bob. So the simplest route here probably would be this with two hops, but it's not that simple because there are a few things we don't know in this case. Because I will show you how the current version of routing works, like described in the current documentation of the real implementation that are available. So what we know? We know what are the payment channels opened in the network, because there is opening transaction and closing transaction that is saved on chain, on Bitcoin's blockchain. So we know all the payment channels. We also know the channel's capacity, because the channels are opened with the specific capacity. Like, for example, channel with 0.1 Bitcoins in it. So there are things we know. With these informations, we are able to build a network graph that allows us to find the route. But the thing we don't know is the channel state. Because, for example, in this example, N is exchanging this value with John. So we don't know on which side the value is at this moment. So for example, in this case, N sends 9 millibits to John, and she owns only 1 millibit. So it won't be possible for her to send him, for example, 3 millibits. And John would be able to send her, for example, 7. So it's about the direction of the channel. We are able to send the payment in one direction, but we are not able to send it in the other. And it's not only about N and John, because it's possible to route payment through their channel. There are other users that can use this channel. In this case, it may be possible to route a payment through the channel, but we aren't sure about it. So the current implementation, like I checked, is quite simple, because it's about trying the possible routes. We don't know what would be the state, and we are unable to get the state of the payment channel of every node in the network. So it's just about trying if it's possible to make a payment in this direction. For example, we try to make a payment, and if the channel state is like we want, for example, we are able to send it in that route, that the payment will be successful. But in the other case, it would be just rejected, and the value would be returned to the sender. And then it's possible to try to select another route. And in some way, we should find a successful route to the destination. It's very simple solution, but it's working pretty well currently. And when the network grows, it would be even easier to find the route. And if we are not able to find the route, we can just open new payment channel to the person we want. But there is also one thing, scalable, instant, and anonymous. Because currently, Bitcoin isn't anonymous. It's only pseudonymous, because we are using pseudonyms that, like this digits that represent the addresses, digits, letters, etc. So we don't have to publish our addresses, but definitely it's not anonymous. So if someone knows our address, that someone would be able to trace the payment in some way. But with Lightning Network, it's possible to make it anonymous. It's the concept is used here. It's known from Tor network, and it's onion routing. How it works in case of Tor network? It's using other nodes, like in this case, we've got some hops that we can make, and we route information through multiple routers or nodes, we select them randomly from the available ones. Then we sign a message and with these nodes public keys. And we send it, for example, to the first router A in this case. And this router A is able to decrypt his part of information, his layer, so he knows the next node. This router only knows the previous one and the next one. So after decrypting, router A is able to send a message to the next router B. And this router B only knows the previous one and the next one. So from the sender's perspective, it's some anonymity in this case, in this moment. But we can select the number of hops. And in this case, router C would be able to decrypt the message, and it would be the destination of this information. And in the similar way, it's possible to build it in the Lightning Network. Like, we use these other nodes to route the value, to route the payment. We can use concepts similar to this to anonymize it. And it's already implemented in some way in the network. What is the current state of it? Because that's definitely a thing that would be interesting. There is a specification called Lightning Protocol. It was published, and it's made by a few companies related to this technology. And it describes the whole concept from routing to finding nodes in details. Also, there are a few implementations. LND written in Go language, Eclair in Scala, and C Lightning in C. So there are already working implementations of this concept. So it's not just a concept anymore. What is probably even more important is that these implementations work already on the Bitcoin's mainnet. So it's not only the test network. It's the main Bitcoin's network. So it's stable enough to use them. And probably what's even more important is that this solution is not just Bitcoin limited. It can be implemented over other blockchains for other use cases. Because there are multiple problems where we don't need the full history of the transactions. We just need this security layer, and we need the final state. So that's all, probably. Thank you. And do you have any questions? Thank you. Yes, so onion routing is not completely safe or anonymous, but we can increase the number of the hops in this case to increase the anonymity. It's also not the most important goal in this case, but we can probably it would be safer in this case because there's less information that can be revealed in this case. For example, the most important bugs or security problem in the case of Tor were, for example, DNS leaks. And it was the probably most popular case in Tor, the biggest problem. Yes, the node only knows the previous one and the next one. So the destination is unknown and also the sender is unknown in some point. So only the first hop and the last one would know the the sender would know that he's a sender and the next node would also know this, but for the next that would be unknown. And in this case I think it's quite a good solution because it's simple. It's already used in a quite big project like Tor. And so the funds are locked in the smart contract here because the nodes, the two nodes that exchange the value make the transaction, sign it, and it's not committed to the blockchain. And it's two of two, so the two keys are needed here to be able to commit it. So then when the value is locked inside the channel, they can update its state of this transaction that isn't committed to the blockchain. And it's all based on smart contracts here. So the smart contracts guarantee us that it's secure. And in the case that when we update the state of the channel, when nodes update the state of the channel, the previous one isn't valid anymore. So only the latest, the newest version is valid here. So smart contracts are simplified in Bitcoin because of the security. It's not Turing complete in this case. For example, there aren't any loops in it. But this script language allows us to write simple scripts or maybe complex enough to write something like this Lightning Network. And it's used, for example, pay to script hash the transaction type uses smart contracts because we can make it's transactions that we are sending value not to the hash of the public's key, that means address, but we are sending it to the person who owns the script and also the needed data if there are any. Yes.
So I can catch this about the limitation of the direction. When you want to send the money in one direction, you may find out that this channel is limited somehow. So it means that you need to
So it's possible to send it in both directions, but there's a limit. When you create an opening transaction, we lock some value in it. So for example, when N locks one millibitcoin in it, so she's able only to send this value. That's the max value. So the whole value would be on the other side of the channel. So the other, the recipient would be able to send back to her this one millibitcoin, but she won't be able to send more on this channel. So she can update the channel and make or open the another one, or route the payment across other channels if she's connected to other nodes by the payment channels. So other nodes are able to send payments through other channels. So I don't have to open the channel to a person I want to send the value to. I can use other channels. I'm connected through other nodes by these channels. Because, yes, because if I want to send a value to the some new person or node or something else, I would have to open this channel to this person and make two transactions on blockchain, the opening transaction and the closing one. And I can make multiple transactions inside this channel then, but it would require me to open two transactions to the person probably I don't want to open it. For example, I won't use the channel that often, that I want to open a channel directly to the person. And then I can, without opening a specific channel to the person, I'm able to route it to the same destination without the need of making these two on-chain transactions. It's just cheaper because every transaction cost can be significant in some cases. So if I want to make like 50 transactions, it would be a significant cost on-chain, for example, in case of micro transactions. Yes, so it's a classic example of the double spend problem that the blockchain solved. In the case of Lightning Network, we don't have this problem because that. But in case of Lightning Network, it's just updating the state between two nodes. So there are just two nodes updating the state of the payment channel because there's their payment channel. So that's not the thing that the whole network have to update. It's they lock this value, then they just update the transaction state. And in the case of blockchain, if they want to just close the channel, it would be committed to the blockchain. And it's our security layer that prevents them from making the double spend. That it would be added to the block. But it's routing through these nodes, the specific nodes that the payment channel is. we just don't need to propagate this transaction across the network. Because in Lightning, it's not like in Bitcoin, for example, that we have to propagate and... in Bitcoin, when the transaction is made, it's propagated through the nodes, and the consensus isn't needed after the transaction. The consensus is needed after the block is mined. Because there's possible to have different state of the nodes across the network. And that's the way, that's the place where blockchain prevents the double spend problem. So we are not able to make two transactions to different users from and to duplicate the value. That's where blockchain was needed. So yes, so if the payment channel is finally closed, that it will be stored on blockchain, yes. Well, they're just storing the current state between these two nodes, if I understand you correctly. Well, it's not blockchain related, and that's a company I work in. Yes. So from user's perspective, it's just using software like we currently use the Bitcoin clients, for example. But in this case, it would be opening the channel directly to the person you want to send the value to, or to any other node in the network. And then you are able to send it. Because the only needed thing is the connection to other node in the network. And it's the only thing that is needed to be able to make the transactions there. Because we are able to route it through other nodes in the network. It's not the thing we have to do manually here. It's all it's all implemented in this clients. How it's possible to do it? Then the simplest implementation is that one that I showed earlier. So it's just selecting nodes that may have a balance of the channel that would allow us to send it. It's possible to find a route based on the transactions that are on Bitcoin's blockchain, because every channel opening is there. So we know what are the open channels across the network, and when they are closed, there has to be saved in the blockchain too. So we know the whole network topology here. We know what amount of bitcoins is locked in every channel in the network. The only thing we don't know is in which side of the tunnel the value is in the specific moment. Because it's a thing that is updated just between two nodes that have the channel opened. So we are just finding the route that may be possible, and if the balance is on the correct side, that the payment would be completed. And in the other case, we have to try another route. It's very simple in this moment. So in this case, yes. So in this case, you only be able to have the confirmation of the block on the Bitcoin side. The confirmation would be on the Lightning side that the payment is completed. If you have the direct payment channel, and then you can commit this final state, and it would be on-chain that you made transactions with specific address, that would be the same here. It's just the layer above blockchain in this case. So there aren't even the same addresses here. Lightning uses other addresses. The smart contracts guarantee us that the value would be the same in this case, that would be in the Bitcoin's level. Because we are locking some value on the Bitcoin's blockchain. Yes, there are separate Lightning addresses. There are, for example, Lightning invoices that we can generate to make a payment. And then the Lightning client gives us the confirmation that it's successful. But it's not directly connected to the Bitcoin addresses.
So from the user perspective, when I open the client application, I can see the amount of funds on my address and my opinion. I want to send my money to some guy from address I know, and I don't want to take care about the channels, about the transactions. I assume that it's similar to Bitcoin from this perspective. I'm saying, okay, well, send this amount of
from user's perspective, it's quite similar in this case. So, for example, in the case of Bitcoin, we don't sign every transaction manually. That's all implemented in the software. And in this case, it's quite similar. And someone can generate us the invoice, the payment ID or address. And then we can just send the value to it. But it's, it don't make sense to send a single payment because it would require us to open a payment channel and then to close it if we want just to make a single payment. So in case of sending it with the classic way on Bitcoin's blockchain, it would require just one transaction. But it's if we want to make few transactions, like for example, we make a transaction every day and we will make, for example, 10 more transactions, then that it makes sense to open this channel, make it on Lightning. And from user's perspective, it's just about selecting the destination and everything else is implemented on this client. They are probably not that user-friendly right now because few of them are just command line. But there are already some mobile light wallets that are quite easy and convenient to use. And it's just a button there, for example, open payment channel, and then the payment channel is opened to the some of the nodes, and then we can just make the transactions for it. Yes, a user is able to decide to what node he wants to open this payment channel. And also the users decide when they want to close this channel. Because the user, when the user wants to use Lightning, he has to lock the specific value on the Bitcoin's blockchain. For example, I can lock 10 millibitcoins there. And I have the same value on the Lightning. So if I want to send Bitcoins and not a value in the Lightning network, so I have to commit this transaction on-chain. Well, that's not required. The time is not defined here. For example, it's possible to have, for example, open channel for a month or for a year. So the only case when I really need to commit this, when someone would try to commit the, for example, not up to date state. For example, these two nodes update the state between them, but we don't want to trust anyone in this case, so that's the design of the network. We don't have to trust anyone. If the second node would try to commit the not up-to-date state, for example, from not the last one, there is another type of closing the channel, because normally the channel has to be closed by the two nodes. There is the normal transaction there, and we can access the funds immediately after it's on the blockchain. But if for example, if one of the nodes disappear, and I want to close my channel to this node, it won't be possible to close it using two nodes. So I can commit transaction, because every of the nodes has the signed transaction. It's just not committed to the blockchain. But there is one more requirement there. It won't be possible to access funds immediately. It's the time lock there. So I will be able to access or to make this transaction on-chain after a specific time. And it's from security perspective, because if one of the nodes won't be available, it's protection that the second one won't commit the incorrect state, the previous one. So the second one has the time to be online again and to see this, and in case it would be a penalty transaction. So if someone tries to steal funds in this case, then this node would lose the channel's state from his side. And blockchain, in this case, is this security layer. We don't have to use it. It's just if we need to, we are able to use it, and it provides us this security. Yeah. Yes, so when this scaling solution would be widely used, the fees would be definitely lower like this. But I can open the channel and use it, for example, for 1 year. So if I have to make two on-chain transactions a year, it won't be that it won't be the problem. It won't, the cost won't be that high. I can make, for example, 1,000 off-chain transactions then in the channel. Yes, I have to make two transactions to be able to make, for example, 1,000 off-chain. Yes. No, because in the case of normal transactions, if I want to make 10, for example, 1,000 transactions, I would have to make 1,000 transactions on-chain. Pay the fee 1,000 times, and in this case, I would have to pay it 2 times. Yes. So my time's up. So thank you. If you have any questions, we can talk directly.